Hey there, everybody. How's it going? Oh, jeez. And then I almost fell. That's a good start to everything. My name is Matt Bolish. I am lucky enough to be the programmer for Convergence, which is the Film Society of Lincoln Center's immersive storytelling and interactive programs. We do programs throughout the year, just like this one, and we also do a sidebar to the New York Film Festival, which will be coming up at the end of September, which is 2 days of intensive workshops, panels, and actually the most exciting part of that is an opportunity to see immersive storytelling projects kind of live, to actually participate, not just hear about them and see a PowerPoint about them, but to actually kind of participate. So we're really excited about that. More information about that will be coming up very, very soon as we announce more about NYFF. But before we kind of get into tonight and all that stuff, just have a little bit of housekeeping stuff, so if you just bear with me for a second. How many of you have never been to the Film Society of Lincoln Center before? First time here at the Film Society. So that's great. So we got quite a few people who've been here before. That's fantastic. And how many of you have signed up for our newsletter? Anybody? There we go. We got people. So see there? See some people. For those of you who do not have our newsletter and sign up for our newsletter, filmlink.com. It's a great way to find out about free events like this as well as ticket sales. We do 365 days of programming at the Film Society. It's not just operating this great first-run theater. It's festivals, it's retrospectives, it's awesome. And in fact, we have just today, NewFest, New York's kind of premier LGBT film festival, just kicking off today across the street, like now-ish. And we just announced yesterday the first full career retrospective of John Waters, which will be happening later in the summer. And we're really excited about that. Lots of personal appearances and some things that have never been shown before. So we're really excited about John Waters. It's going to be huge. And of course, actually before I get to that one, we also have upcoming later on in August, Sound and Vision, which is a relatively new festival we're doing that focuses on music documentaries. And there's a couple of things that actually really kind of fit within the immersive storytelling space, specifically on August 5th, a film about Glass Ghosts, the Brooklyn-based band, will be a live kind of experience, performance, as well as a film. So this is really exciting, and we hope you check out Sound and Vision, all of our other programs on the FilmLink website, including the New York Film Festival. NYFF is our big, 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 super giant event. We've already announced opening, centerpiece, and closing. We're really excited to have the world premiere of David Fincher's new film, Gone Girl, as well as P.T. Anderson's Inherent Vice, and we'll be closing with Birdman, starring Michael Keaton. So it's really, really exciting. We've got a considerable, a lot more coming as far as that's concerned. So it's going to be a great fest this year. When we decided to do this panel, we were kind of thinking, like, what do we want to talk about? What do we want to get these creators together to talk about? And all the people that we have here are really exceptional makers and builders and filmmakers and experienced designers and whatever, however many hyphens you want to put in between their names or their titles. They always talk about what they do to succeed. We always want to hear from them about the great things they've done, those projects that kind of define careers. Tonight we're here to talk about the corpses they had to crawl over to get there. Today is about failure, but it's not just about kind of pointing and laughing and having a good time talking about the mistakes that have been made. We're going to be talking about what we've learned from those failures and the fact that you actually need to fail if you're going to endeavor to do any kind of artistic endeavor in order to succeed. And for that reason, we're really happy to have these failures here with us today. So I'm going to bring down Brian Clark, who's our moderator, and he's going to bring everybody else down. And then we'll get started. So thank you very much, guys. Thanks for coming.
Presentation about their failures. So we're going to do this a little bit more like a nice, quiet conversation among people. We've been talking about this idea now for a year, I think. And I think there's enough of us in the creator space now who are like, yeah, if I have to watch one more PowerPoint about what a remarkable success it was and how you did it, I'm going to shoot myself in the head. That's what we were saying. Like, let's start talking about like what didn't go well, like what messed up. So I'm really happy tonight because this becomes a really easy panel to moderate because I've known these three people for a really long time. Andrea Phillips is an amazing art game author. You'll get to hear a little bit about Anand Failure at some point, I'm sure. Michael Anderson is the historian of this format, has probably covered it for longer and also made stuff, and also works in advertising for Shatter. And then the end is my old-time buddy, Lance Weiler, who has gone through job titles, five or 2 years, you change the name of what you're doing, but filmmaker, artist, provocateur, toy designer. So we'll get a nice, interesting set of glimpses here. But what we quickly realized is failure is such a gigantic topic. There's absolutely no way we could cover all of it in one night. So we tried to focus our failures for this panel on very public failures with the audience. Not like things we did strategically wrong, or not like a business failure, but like forgetting the lines to Hamlet on stage level right out there in front of the audience. But we thought we might start on a more positive note. So Michael, do you want to tell us why it's good to fail?
Yeah, so, and I think one of the things that's a real challenge is we do have these carved out niches where it's socially acceptable to fail in certain situations. So I work in advertising, and part of what I do is I crunch the numbers for a lot of advertising campaigns. And part of that involves doing A/B testing, where you're turning around and you're saying, okay, I'm going to give what I hope is a bad experience to at least half the audience so that I can find out what a good experience looks like. This is a case where failure is the only way you get the information of what people actually like, what people want. And I found it really interesting that there are these socially carved out niches where we say it's okay to fail in this particular situation. So,
I think you need to go deeper. I think you need to explain to people what an A/B test is.
Yeah, so with A/B testing, you basically turn around and say, okay, I want to do one of two things, and I'm not sure which one is the right thing to do. So rather than just flip a coin and say, that's the one that's the right way to go, I feel like it's right, you take a group of people and you divide them up into two groups. You say, you get that one part, and you get the other part. So if you've got a website, you give them a blue website for one group, a green website for the other. And if you fail properly, then you'll find out people like one over the other. If not, you find out that nobody really cares, and it's just a website. And there are a lot of those situations like that where we say, yeah, no, whatever, go ahead and fail. Competitions, I think it was 2 years ago at this point, in this room, I participated in a story hack, and I'm starting this off because if I don't bring it up, Brian will. But as part of that story hack, I made the horrible failure decision, and it was a 48-hour story hack, and I figured we're going to need all this time to prepare. So I got about 2 hours of sleep during this process, ends up with a presentation, and Brian is very nice. The moment that he latches onto during this presentation is I made a bit of a slip of the tongue and referred to the lucrative money industry.
The lucrative money industry. He was going to get into the lucrative money industry.
Glorious. What he is nice enough not to mention is I was so out of it at this point, by the end of the presentation, I actually tried to drop the mic. And thank you for focusing on the nicer end of that particular failure. But this is still an area where it was socially acceptable. It's a contest. You know there's going to be one winner. You know it's okay to fail. It was a small project. You know to fail. But as I said before, you're taking information from these failures, and if you're not taking risks even with larger situations, then you're kind of dooming yourself to only learn very small lessons.
So how much of the internet that people experience is the result of blind A/B testing?
Oh God, way too much. So anytime you're going to any e-commerce site practically, you're seeing not just A/B testing, but what they refer to as multivariate testing, where there's dozens or even hundreds of experiments going on all at one time to find out, does the button need to be just a little bit bigger? If I move this pixel a little over there, is that going to change things? And a lot of that is done on the automated side, so you are dehumanizing the process a little bit. That it's about the shifts in the aggregate number is not what individuals are experiencing. And that's another kind of failure.
Or if I can do another example, everyone makes fun of the one weird trick to lose belly fat. Like, this is what A/B testing looks like. I'm sure no one knows why, but that one produced the best click-through rate, and so they run it everywhere. Because in the competition of ideas, people clicked on that one more.
Well, even with the Nigerian scammers, one of the big things that, there was actually a research study done where they were taking a look at it, and they found out that the reason the English is so bad, and the grammar's mangled, the stories are unbelievable, is because you get better conversion rates from people responding to those emails if you get the really dumb ones who fall for the first part, so you don't want to waste the time of the person who actually needs to have a conversation with you. The scam emails we get are the result of A/B testing.
Everything is terrible. See, I told you, this was the uplifting portion of the conversation. Andrea, I want to go to you because you wanted to tell a story about, like, logistical failure, like letting the audience down.
Story time. Once upon a time, I was engaged to make an alternate reality game in connection with a summer blockbuster film. This was a marketing campaign.
Okay, so hold on one second. How many people know what an alternate reality game is? Oh, not bad. Maybe give a little description.
In connection with the movie. It was kind of a prequel that you played out as if it were really happening. And as one does, we wanted to have some sort of physical event where the players could go out into the real world and retrieve a piece of information, because that's a great showing moment. That's a great experience to provide to an audience. But we didn't want to have to pay all of the money to do things like scout out payphone sites and on and on. So we struck on the idea of doing a media buy. And this media buy, we thought we were being very clever, was on Pump Top TV. Pump Top TV on a screen on top of the gas pumps at a gas station. This is New York, so it's possible that many of you have never seen ads. But this is a thing that really exists in the real world. So we recorded a little bit of video, and the video had, you know, I think a URL in it, and you could get more information or documents if you hit that URL and got the secret cash that was supposed to be for the secret agent who was supposed to be there instead of you, et cetera, whatever. Hand-waving story stuff. So this was all scheduled to go off on a weekend morning, and I decided that I would get up at 8 o'clock on a Saturday morning to go and make sure that my local gas station with Pump Top TV was showing the right thing, because quality assurance is crucial, right? It's a basic step. You need to make sure that the thing that you're putting in front of your audience is actually there. And it wasn't there. So I went to another gas station that was a little further away from my house, and it wasn't there either. And then I realized I might have a crisis on my hands. So I went to Twitter to see if any of the players had noticed. And they had. I had one player who also happened to be separately a friend of mine who I like very much. She was waiting in the parking lot of a gas station for something to show up on that screen that was going to be worth her time, worth the drive to the gas station, because she had to go to a gas station that was far from her house to see this thing that wasn't there. And then I had a horrible dilemma. Do I let her sit in the gas station? I didn't have keys to any of the social media accounts or any of the email accounts for the characters in this story for logistical reasons. And because it was 6 o'clock on Saturday morning in Los Angeles, I couldn't reach any of those people who did have the keys to get them to do anything official and in story to fix the problem. We're sorry, folks, there's a delay here. So ultimately, I think this may be the only time in my career I've done it. I reached out to that player directly and personally through direct message. I said, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. something screwed up. I don't know what it is. Go home. And she was very kind about it. I think a lot kinder than we deserved. And ultimately, the problem we found was that our video file was enormous according to Pump Top TV standards. And it was too big to propagate with any speed through their network of Pump Top TVs. It turns out that gas pumps don't have great broadband.
Who knew?
So that was the story.
So what did you do big systemically to fix that though? Because like this is one of the things this kind of interactive work is. You don't get to just do it over. You have to write your way out of the problem.
I think in this case we did a little bit of writing of, oh no, they're onto us, the bad guys were gonna catch us, so we had to change what we were doing. Something really.
But did you feel like that it was a minor correction, or did you guys have to do like a major rewrite, or?
It wound up being a fairly minor correction, because most people hadn't hit the gas stations, you know, on the first hour of the first day. We were really lucky that it was mostly just one person, and then when she said, there's nothing here, nobody felt compelled to go out and check their own gas pumps with great urgency until a little later, by which time it actually had started propagating. It was over a period of like 5 or 6 hours, I think, where they started actually appearing where they were supposed to.
How long did someone have to stand and watch the gas pump before they would see the video?
It was long. It was like a 3-minute video, and I think there were like 5 minutes of video in all. It was not a lengthy thing at all. Unless you wanted to watch it more than once.
Lance, you were heading out in scale of broadness, and you wanted to talk about like network level scales. Like scales that are one person's experience being messed up, but like a lot of people's experiences.
Sure. Well, first of all, I should say I've had many, many epic failures and some successes too. I think that in terms of what I wanted to share was a story about kind of going in and being really excited about being able to get the pilot or something. You know, anybody that's developed television, hats off to anybody who can actually be able to develop something, let alone actually get the pilot, let alone be picked up for series and something. And it's such a small percentage. I think by the time you're actually doing a pilot, you're like 2% of whatever it is and the people who are doing it. And it was a situation where I was really excited about what it was and had kind of put myself full into it, kind of convinced myself that this thing, I was gonna will this thing to happen, that it was gonna totally work out, that it was gonna be really great. And I think some of the things that became apparent as we went and we started to go through it and we went off and encountered a lot of difficulties, difficulties in terms of like, I think the concept which was anchored in this idea of a reality program, kind of celebrating fan culture, had some really strong attributes to it. It had its heart in the right place. It really, I think it still think it could work. But we found ourselves in a situation where I think in terms of the team and who we brought together, a lot of ambition, a lot of excitement, but not necessarily the right team to bring together. And started to experience these things that were just, I think it would have been such a better reality program if it would have actually been documenting us in terms of what we were going through as opposed to what we actually had on screen. And the level of drama that existed in actually trying to make that pile was like so insane.
There's a specific, like make it tangible.
High speed, like driving and being with a colleague who was very upset and was just blowing red lights while we were actually fist fights and editing bays. It was just, there was a lot, it was very epic. And at that same time, I put all the eggs in one basket. You know what I mean? I put it all in there. I was like, we're going to make this work. And there was like a changing of the, it was classic. It was like a changing of the guard, and the new guard came in, and the show had the stench of the previous one, and they were just like, kill. You know, and then it was like, you felt like you went through the five stages of grief, you know, and you're like, okay, I'm in denial. It's the greatest show in the world, and now I'm in a bargain, you can cut days. And then you're angry, how dare you not take this show? And then you're totally depressed. And then you hit acceptance. And you kind of bounce around all throughout those things throughout the whole time. But I think that, it was something where I kind of walked away from that and I realized, okay, and this sounds obvious, the team is really important. You know, the team is really important. And then also feeling like at a certain point where you're so focused on that one singular thing, you think you can really will it into existence. And you kind of find yourself so far off compass, you know, from where your gut's telling you, you know, just like, okay, well, somebody knows better. But meanwhile, it's like inside you saying it's wrong, it's wrong. But you kind of just put it aside and you just go forward. And you know, that's like easily a couple million dollar failure, you know, it's just like, but the worst part is like going into debt, you know, on my end. And they're like, television is like tenant farming, you know what I mean? Like. And all of a sudden, not only did I go through this whole thing that ended up taking up a couple of years, and then it was dead, I found myself on the other side of it, in debt, and then like totally questioning everything that I was doing. I was like, what the hell just happened? You know, and then from that moment forward, it was like this light bulb. It was like, okay, never again, I'm gonna diversify what I do. You know, I'm gonna find ways to tell stories and diversify that and not necessarily be beholden to one particular thing.
So talk more about that. Because I think the learning lesson is, how did you diversify? Like, because you're both saying both that it's about the team, but it's also about you and like the way you were doing things. Like, how did you change from that? Like, once you got out of debt and out of depression?
Just kind of, in terms of diversification, just started to look at other ways that I could tell stories and started to explore opportunities of how I could be more entrepreneurial in different. Like whether it be building software, whether it was creating new types of opportunities for the work that I was doing, meaning like maybe I moved into, at that time I started to do more that was kind of live event. I started to do things that were, I was working in film and television. But I think fundamentally it was just kind of saying, okay, I'm going to have more of a development slate, you know, in terms of how I approach it, which is, it's common. Do that. But I think even more so now within traditional media, whether you're working in film or television, like the whole state of, even though there are more television outlets now, it's still not necessarily, the process is broken, you know, in terms of how they bring things out to market. And, it, you know, independent film, which I had cut my teeth on and done a lot with, is like totally, you know, that's bottom down.
Yeah.
So the diversification ended up being a really good thing for me. Before that whole bottomed out, it was before there was like, the pilot system's been broken for a while. But, and then for myself, I think it was just more of like, how could I find time to do like trials with people? Like, how could I rapidly prototype something or bring together a group of people and think about what it meant to be collaborative with others and find ways to do it faster, find ways to identify certain types of behaviors or certain things that could just see within team dynamics. And then the other part was just building the confidence to go with what I felt was right, to listen to what that internal voice was. And that sounds very simple, but it's actually very challenging to do.
I was actually gonna tease you there for a minute because I was like, my gosh, you didn't even say the word prototype once. But you redeemed yourself there at the end with the prototype. So I'm gonna tell the story of why the Secret Service investigated me. So we were making a film called Nothing So Strange, which was sort of a faux documentary. It's a fictional story that we were shooting in the real world. So we would shoot at police corruption hearings. We had time on the protest stage outside the Democratic National Convention in Los Angeles. And so it was very sort of reality hack production, which meant that actors were largely improv. So we needed a rich shared mythology that they could all sort of immerse themselves in, so that when they improv'd in these very uncontrolled situations, they had a body to draw from. So we had very elaborate websites about the history that this documentary was looking at, which starts with the assassination of Bill Gates in 1999. Now, where we had set this, this was in the past. So we're filming in 2000, but we have fake CNN articles from 10 minutes after he was shot. We have Gil Garcetti's open and shut case that it was a single gunman who killed him. It was sort of the familiar trappings of like conspiracy theory. So, and that meant we'd had long discussions as filmmakers about where were these ethical lines. Like, it's okay to say Bill Gates got killed. It's not okay to say, let's kill Bill Gates. Like, you know, little ethical lines like this. And we're very careful as we made all of this to sort of follow that ethical line so that our audience did not feel as constrained by it. So one fan took that CNN page and made a copy and changed one thing. Instead of saying December 2nd, 1999, it was now a JavaScript that automatically made it today's date, whenever you were looking at it. And the South Korean television press picked it up as news. And like, breaking news, Bill Gates shot dead in Los Angeles, and Microsoft's stock began to tank the Korean stock market. And so they froze all trading in the South Korean stock market. And that was when my phone rang from the Secret Service. Because at the same time, there had been these people who were trying to devalue Asian currencies. And so they thought perhaps I was an Asian currency devaluer. And instead, I was trying to describe to them that I was making a film. And they were like, oh, so you have a film? And like, not a whole film yet, no. And Secret Service agent going, well, how do I know there's really a film? And at that moment, I thought, oh God, I'm gonna go to jail. How do you prove that it's a film when you haven't finished it? And I think that was the moment when I began to realize that you don't really have control over the audience. When you do something like this in a rough draft form, like, what were you gonna do, sue them? Make it uncopyable. And so there's a sort of danger of releasing something into the world, especially when it's got a sort of provocative standpoint. As much as we thought, okay, someone might be fooled that Bill Gates just got killed, but no one's gonna think Bill Gates got killed a year ago and they didn't notice. Like, oh, how did I miss that news? But that line was more dangerous than we thought. I always like to do a comparison to, it's not the worst failure I've ever heard of, Adult Swim. You know, this is a classic story in Boston where they had made these really cool little gadgets that were like LEDs on a battery that looked like characters from like Adult Swim stuff, and they were like gorilla. They were like, you know, like glued or magneted, so they would like throw them up on bridges and stuff, and someone reported it as a bomb threat. So they brought bomb squads out to start to defuse these LED characters. And prosecuted the people who put that on and charged them $2 million for the bomb squad stuff. And that guy lost his job, and Adult Swim was not interested in guerrilla work anymore. So I think certainly, even when you don't think, because like, to me, that is one of my favorite failures to talk about, because I would have never thought people would have thought that was a bomb. Like, that never would have even entered into the realm of what I would have tried to plan for. And yet, cost people their jobs, cost television network, 2 million fines, lots of the wrong kind of press.
Well, and just to interject with another example, because all of these are so far examples where you're thinking, oh, you know, we can still think, oh, that person maybe should have known better. Not in Brian's case, it was the guy who switched up the website who really made a mistake. But a lot of times, especially when you're dealing with interactive projects, it's just those small assumptions that you never would have thought. So one of my favorite examples along these lines is there was another alternate reality game for the Halo 3 video game. Now, I'm not talking about the one, if you've heard about one, where there was bees and telephone calls to pay phones. This particular one was a little bit more sedate, but as part of it, they had an Xbox profile with, and Xbox profiles have these nine-digit numbers associated with them. And the players looked at this nine-digit number and they thought, well, nine digits, that's just one digit off from 10 digits. 10 digits, that's a phone number, I gotta call this. So they cycled through the nine-digit number plus one for the 10 iterations, and all of a sudden they find one of those phone numbers has video game characters from this very popular web series called Red vs. Blue, and characters in the Halo universe are talking on the phone. This is it, we found the solution. No, it was just a college student who was a fan of this web series, and he ended up getting tens of thousands of phone calls because everybody following this game was, oh my goodness, this is it. You can't plan away mistakes in any project. The only thing you can do is program in escape hatches so that you can quickly back up. So Andrea, you had mentioned that if only you had the keys to the Twitter accounts, you could take action. Giving people the tools so that you can have rapid responses, especially if you're talking about interactive campaigns, is so necessary. And giving people the authority to actually do that, because again, in advertising, a lot of times I can technically do things, but I don't necessarily have the authority to do things unless the processes within the company says, yes, you have permission to go in and do things that are off script.
So Andrew, talk to me, like, so if you have failures, does that make you more bold or less bold in the next work you do?
It depends on the failure. I find from an ethical point of view, as time goes on, I get less and less bold. Because I've seen too many projects that fall afoul of ethical lines in ways that we wouldn't have chosen to or wouldn't even have predicted. I like to talk a lot about the project that starts with a missing girl flyer plastered around on a campus, and the problem is that a lot of designers go into the world with their designer hat on and they don't realize that someone walking down the street isn't going to see a flyer like that and think, oh, how intriguing, I am going to visit this website. They think, wow, that's super scary, I'm gonna lock my door when I get home. So in that perspective, I get more and more cautious with each passing year, which I regret a little bit. It's tragic to have kind of a little lawyer in the back of your head always telling you that idea you have is not actually viable.
A little lawyer in the back of your head, that's the quote of the panel, I think.
But at the same time, I've been getting bolder, or I've been trying to get bolder regarding logistical efforts. So, sometimes you hold the live event and you get there and unexpectedly they don't actually have any Wi-Fi the way that they told you to. And all you can do is scramble and try and find a way to make do. This was a thing that happened with a big, big Perplexity finale live event. And we wound up, instead of having things automatically update, there was a score for the people on the ground and for the people on the internet, and it was cumulative. And I wound up on the phone all day with somebody in Seattle, San Francisco, someone in San Francisco and someone in London, conveying the score from the people on the ground to the people in London so they could update the website and make it look live. It was not our easiest event, but we managed to pull it off anyway. And I would do something like that again because the effect was worth it to the audience, even if it wound up being about 5 times harder than we had expected it to be in implementation.
Well, Lance, I'm kind of interested in your reaction to the same question because I'm wondering if there might be some contrast. Does failure scare you? Does it make you approach projects with more trepidation?
No. And I don't think I have a lawyer in the back of my all that aside, I think I'm really into a kind of, like, this idea. There's a really great book by Peter Sims, it's called Little Bets, and it's a really interesting book because he talks about, through a series of little bets, you could have a potential big breakthrough. And he goes and he embeds himself within Pixar, and he talks about how Pixar started as a kind of software company, but then they became frustrated because the way that people were using the software wasn't what they wanted. So then they started to, or how they thought it should be used. So then they started to make some short films and started to tell some stories with it. And I guess you kind of know where that ended up. And, you know, they moved from being a software company to becoming a storytelling company. For me, I think it's really I'm excited by that edge. I'm excited by that kind of chaos at times, you know, where you're not really sure what's going to happen. And the leaving yourself open for the potential, especially as things become more and more driven by, you know, it's not so much a broadcast medium, even though we're sitting here and we're talking to you. That idea that more and more people are kind of like their own media companies and you can bubble up. And so I think some of the best things that I've been doing over the last couple of years have come from these moments where you just kind of set the space and you kind of let it happen. And I think, for example, like I was in Philadelphia yesterday and I was doing this part of this Places project where one of the poorest neighborhoods in the city and they brought in all these different artists and residents to work with the students that are there. And we were running through just rapid prototyping with them, you know, like trying to embracing these ideas of design thinking and play and storytelling, but watching, allowing them to fail and seeing how incredibly liberating that can be. You know, and doing it in a way where you do it in an environment where you can paper test something or you can try it, or you can actually go out and embrace like design research, which is a different approach to the A/B testing, but that idea of where you go out and you actually talk and you discover what that need is. And I think that's been really valuable. But I think I'm excited by those edges. I'm excited by those places where it might all just totally combust, because there are times where it totally works.
Yeah.
You know, like there was one moment that could have been incredibly epic failure. Can I share this real quick?
Oh, you're going to do a non-failure? I think we can let you. We can let you.
Oh, yeah.
The risk factor's there.
Okay, there was definitely the risk factor. We're getting ready to do this thing that involves a release of a movie, and we were looking to do it digitally. And so I cold called some satellite companies. And
old story on this one, right?
Super old, but I think relevant. So I called them, and we were trying to walk away with like $85,000, I think, at the time to do this event. And what ended up happening was, like, we kept talking, and the company kept saying, are you talking to Boeing? Are you talking to Boeing? And they kept saying that, and I kept saying, I kept avoiding it. And then they eventually came back, and they kept asking me, and I said, if you ask me again, I'm going to have to leave. And then they said it again, and I hung up the phone. And then my producer, Esther Robinson, calls me up. She's like, what the hell are you doing? And I'm like, I don't know. I think maybe it'll work out. Let's see what happens. And it was a long, like, 45 minutes. And then they called back, and we ended up with, like, $2.5 million in R&D money to do something. But it was like that. It could fail miserably, you know? Like, but it was like, okay, you know, I guess maybe I take risks. You know, so it was that going out on that edge. So I think sometimes that can be a valuable thing.
So I want to like start to round up so we can get to questions. But Michael, you spent part of your time as a journalist reviewing this kind of interactive work and writing about it from an audience's experience. So do audiences want us to be afraid of failure? Like, where's the tension between wanting to believe from the beginning that our shit is buttoned down so that they can trust us as storytellers and wanting us to take risks and push the edges?
I think audiences can be very forgiving of mistakes, especially early on when they're seeing something where you can feel that there are risks, involved, absolutely. Going to be throwing another campaign under the bus. There was a campaign out of Court TV a while ago called Save My Husband. And Save My Husband had, I'm going really rare here. So this campaign, Save My Husband, was about, I think it was about somebody who was kidnapped, and they took out these banner advertisements all over the internet, driving people to an interactive online experience where you could do the video and interact and help the woman find her missing husband. But one of the mistakes that they went through is, if you have a banner advertisement that's saying, my husband is missing, help me, and you put it up on cute overload, then people aren't necessarily going to get that this is a fictional story. They're going to be actively worried that, oh my goodness, something's going wrong with this woman's husband. We need to get out there. We need to call the police. We need to do something. However, this is still an experience where once people got over the hump and once Court TV pulled back and put disclaimers all over on the banner advertisements, put disclaimers on the website saying, hey, this isn't as real as you think it is, that they did actively embrace and think that this is a campaign that I can get behind. Lance, throwing you under the bus too. Hope is Missing. Hope is Missing was actually my introduction to a lot of your work. And the same thing happened where it was way back in the days of Stage 6.
Yes.
And this was
desperate.
Yeah. This was something where, again, there was a, I still don't understand how people didn't realize it was fictional, because there was levitating candles, I think. All sorts of really, like, very fantastical elements. But because it was put in an environment where people weren't used to it, there was a decent amount of pushback where people were thinking, well, is this real? And that question, is this real, is something that will get a lot of resistance, whether you're talking about an independent film, whether you're talking about Lonely Girl 15. But once you get over that hurdle of clarifying, people are willing to forgive you. That people are willing to say, except apparently for Lance's list of death threats. I played through that campaign. There's quite a few players on that side.
Yeah, no. And I think that's good. But some people will never forget. Never forget.
Never forget.
Never forget.
Well, apparently I didn't forget.
Yeah.
So I thought I might close it by bringing it back down to, like, really small. I hate perfection. Like, I find it deeply intimidating. The metaphor I always use is I journal. So I buy, you know, journal books, and there's nothing more intimidating to me in the world than a fresh, blank, perfect, unblemished journal book. And so the first thing I always do, this could maybe sound like I need to be watched by the police, but the first thing I do with every journal is I deface it. I chop a corner off the cover. I rip out the first four pages. Because, like, as soon as it's not perfect, then I can put whatever I want in it, right? But otherwise, the, like, thought that, like, each thing that I put down is going to diminish the perfection of this object that I have in my head is a, you know, is a really hard barrier for me as an artist. And so I work the opposite way. I work, like, all great things start as shit, right? And making mistakes in a way that you don't get death threats or calls from the Secret Service is nice, but unnecessary. Like, it's far more important to mess it up and make it better from there. So I thought with that, like, where are we at, Matt? How much time do we have for questions?
15 minutes.
15 minutes?
Yeah.
Do we have a mic for... Okay, I'm trusting you guys to ask interesting questions or to reveal your own failures. We'll pause one moment for the recording.
Cooperation. I guess failure is a way of talking about risk, and the word risk has come up. It's been my observation, and maybe it's a very black and white observation, that the companies that are most capable of taking the biggest risks are the least likely to. That the more successful they become, the safer they play it. And there are possible exceptions, maybe FX in terms of cable TV might be. But why is that? I feel like if I was the head of a conglomerate, I would have 1 year, I would have enough money to parachute myself out, and I see, and I would literally burn their profits. I would say, here's what we're gonna do, we're gonna set a match.
This is why you're a television exec, right?
But I mean, it would be interesting as an experiment, or I would put like 4 hours of prime time screaming up, you know, something that would not, what they think of as taking risks is laughable. So I'm just wondering, can that ever change? Can ever the lunatics be running the asylum ever again, even for a month?
So my thought is, like Lance, I come out of the independent film tradition of the late 20th century, back in its, like, there's a great Esquire article just recently about how 1999 was the last good year of film. Mm-hmm. There hasn't been a good year since then. Like, you had some important work that year too, but they go through the list of, like, films, you know,
being John Malkovich, Blair Witch Project, Magnolia, Fight Club, The Matrix. There was like something in the water that year that film was taking all these miraculous risks. It wasn't a superhero film in the top 10, right? And like something has been lost in cinema now because in part the films aren't getting made. And I think what you're seeing in television is ripe for disruption, but all of the disruptors seem to be wanting to recreate the studio model. And so I look at what Netflix is doing, and I look at what Amazon is doing, and I look at what Hulu is doing, and they're trying to reproduce a pilot system. Like a Project Greenlight, sort of, we're gonna focus test it up like American Idol to this perfect little
thing. So what's the answer to that? Is it coming, will it be a grassroots overthrow?
I think so. I mean, I think if you want to look at where it's happening right now, it's happening on YouTube. It's happening among people that, like, we're too old to even know their names, and yet people treat them like pools when they show up at these maker conferences. You were at one of these recently,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I went to VidCon a couple weeks ago, and I got stuck parking far away, and I was, like, wandering up, and I wandered into the back of the convention hall, the Anaheim Convention Hall, and I had no badge. I was just wandering around, but all the guards were so... you know, they were like hall monitors because there were all these teenagers running and screaming, just following any YouTube star that they would see. And it was like insane because like they had the collection there had billions and billions of views and like 2.5, 6, 7, 8 million subscribers to what they did. But then the brands were there and then the studios were there and then everybody was kind of looking at what they were doing. But there would be these scenes where all of a sudden they push by you, they'd be screaming, they run, and all their phones would go up. They couldn't even see what was happening. But all their phones are up, and then they're turning their phones, talking about what's going on, and then putting it back up. But it was like, they were also creators. You know? So the creators were, it was like this meta thing that was going on.
Or my favorite example recently is, like, you guys know Batdad? Yes. Like, basically the Vine star that's like, talking to his kids in the back seat with the Batman mask on. But now they're having to do car commercials. Like, I'm getting all these pre-rolls on YouTube of my new Ford Prius and this one. You're just like, whoa. So I think, you know, what you'll see is something that bubbles out of a grassroots that challenges the status quo.
If they're co-opting, if they're selling out, which is a term apparently anyone under 25 doesn't even know what that means.
I was going to say, I don't think selling out exists anymore.
If selling out doesn't exist anymore, then is this... ultimately, no good. I mean, there needs to be a
revolution.
You know, there needs to be.
I'm with you. Let's do it. Let's storm the Brooklyn Bridge. I'm ready. I'm ready. We're going to put the white flag up there.
I think one of the challenges, specifically to your question, we're dealing with is do we not have the C levels really making those big risks? Stock options.
I know that.
Okay. If you have a system that incentivizes
sure.
The next. A lot of times when I look at benchmarks, when I think about the idea of a benchmark, what it should be is saying, this is the norm, we can try to go beyond the norm, but for every step we take above that, we're taking a little bit of risk and we need to accept a little bit more failure. And we're treating that idea of a benchmark as just what has to happen. And that's just not how entertainment works, that's not how media works, that's not how people work. It's not like somebody goes into the office one day and says, you know, I'm going to do the worst work possible just so those other people look good when they're really trying hard.
Well, but to just do another metaphor, I think what was making independent film work in the late 20th century was the cost of production had become just zero. Like, the ability to shoot on digital video, the ability to edit on a computer was like opening up these vistas of filmmaking. And so I think as soon as we stop seeing Netflix and Amazon greenlighting $20 million television series, we'll see some sign. And where I'm still seeing like great vibrancy is not in the, you know, the FXs or the HBOs, but is in like Robert Rodriguez's El Rey, right? Like my DVR right now is recording Kung Fu movies. Because Thursday night, they're always doing like Hong Kong Kung Fu movies that like literally you can't find on Netflix. Like they found the island of misfit toys or programming them. And so I think those are the kinds of places where we'll see something Germany back up against. But meanwhile, the rest of television is kind of failing. It's getting critical reviews, but even the people that are taking the risks are doing it for subscriber retention and not really for the audience numbers and the Nielsen numbers that they used to. So change will come.
Yeah. We got mice now.
I'm an animator, and I just got out of school for it. And I have this problem where I feel that there's a mediator in between keeping it safe, because I really appreciate what you said about how you have your own personality of what perfect, you don't, the book thing, you said, I don't want to see it perfect because I have this thing, which is me. So it's like, where do you draw the line between misunderstood, which is most of the problems I've heard right now is this misunderstandings going on, between like, with a lot of movies, like, or shows, bomb threats to South Park, Family Guy, or that new movie coming out with James Franco and all this.
Jude Law Hill. Like, where do you kill James Franco? That's a great one, right?
Yeah. Like, what do you do? These people are like, we're misunderstood. So, I might have a goal for a pitch or a pilot.
Yep.
But, is there a way to avoid that or just take the risk? And if I have to take the risk, or if I don't take the risk, how safe do I need to keep it?
So as an indie, and I know you're going to approve of this, Lance, I'm going to quote a wonderful filmmaker who's no longer with us named Sarah Jacobson, who brought the DIY punk aesthetic into indie film in the late 1990s. And her argument was, stop asking for someone's permission. Right? Hey, if the studio says no, call the theater. If the theater says no, call a high school. If the high school says no, set up a projector in a park. Like, what's keeping you from showing your film, from making this film? And I think that's what I would especially encourage people earlier in their career. Don't fall into the trap of pitching. I know people who have been carrying around the same pitch from meeting to meeting for 3 years, and it means they're not making it. Roger Ebert also famously at Sundance, when he would meet people on the street, was a very magnanimous fellow, people would say, oh, I'm a filmmaker. And you go, oh, so what are you making? He's like, well, I got this treatment that I'm pitching. And he'd be like, oh, so you want to be a filmmaker? Or they'd say, oh, I made this film. He goes, oh, so you were a filmmaker. And his argument was, you're a filmmaker if you're making a film. So you're an animator if you're animating something. So anything that gets in the way of you like doing that, save that for later. Like, wait for them to call you. Wait for them to start to knock on your door. What can you do with your own hands? What can you do that an audience wants and gets them engaged?
That said, given some of the kinds of things that we do, if there is a risk of causing substantial and material harm to people, as a result,
there's the lawyer back.
And they're going to go off of their meds, or they're going to not go to the doctor. I worked on a project a long time ago where we had to deal with some pretty stringent legal requirements in England. Not OSHA, but it was something sort of along those lines. And we were making a fictional pharmaceutical company website, and we ran into trouble thinking of fake news that wouldn't persuade somebody with a real condition that, there might be a treatment for Parkinson's disease, 5 years away, and if they just hang on, they could have that new treatment instead of whatever it is they were going to do now. So, not that you're going to go and have people murder each other, but, if you're asking people to break into a house as a part of a live event, maybe consider the possibility that they're going to get the address wrong.
So you're saying my real-life Hunger Games idea is not a good one?
It bears thinking through the implications, right?
Failure is looking at that one.
Yeah, see?
I have a very slight general question that's not media-specific, but an idea like story is conflict. If there was no failure or conflict, we'd be cows grazing in the meadow, we'd have no brain in our head. So if failure is like the beginning where you're wounded, you'll be healed, it's like nature, life works that way, hello. Where does this, you know, from the time you're a child, you're 5 years old, it's drilled into your head that if you fail, you should be humiliated and shamed for a lifetime and give up on everything. And by the time you get out, you're just, you know, a Pinocchio puppet that'll just do whatever a couple of people want you to do. So when it comes to this complete, almost like institutionalized insanity, this imbecility that failure is bad, I'm just curious from you, with media more engaged, involved, when you find that life works like we're not told, and every opportunity is based, ironically, when you get down to it, on failure. I'm just curious, when you hear this, how do you react, or what could be done, particularly maybe from an, you know, an educational point of view, because 5-year-olds are getting drilled for 12 years old to give up because they made a mistake in kindergarten.
I think I might be able to at least take part of this by starting off with another admission of failure. I'm a failed lawyer. Went through law school, graduated.
Aren't they all?
So I did pass, and I am a lawyer, but I have not worked a day of law in my life since getting out of the internship. Came out in a kind of bad economy, and I pivoted. Started working in advertising, started pulling on a lot of the writing and covering this general space that I've been doing. And I think, in a certain extent, yes, it's getting a lot harder where there is pressure to keep succeeding, succeeding, succeeding. But then when you see where that path takes you of all those success, that a lot of times that path of success is looking like you're a consultant, you're an iBanker. Those aren't as fulfilling. So at the same time as you have that path to success where people drop out when they realize that's not what they wanted, you also have people who realize that, no, we're not getting jobs for a lifetime if that's something that ever even existed. So you pivot. I switched industries once. I'm probably going to switch industries again. I am definitely going to be switching the type of work that I do, because as I evolve, as my work evolves, as Lance was talking about, he switched what he was doing, partially because of failure, partially because he was seeing other opportunities. So in some ways it's harder now, in some ways it's a lot easier.
If I could, on the education side, because I have a son who's 6 years old, and I'm dyslexic, and I was almost held back at school, I never went on to university. He was diagnosed in a similar way, and immediately the school wanted to, you know, they recommended medication, they recommended all these things, and so we pulled him out, we put him into a Montessori program, reduced his screen time, changed his diet, and saw total change. You know, it was really amazing. And so I started to look more and more about, like, what was going on within the Montessori school. It was really interesting in terms of the discovery-based education there. And then started playing with the idea of how you could use story as a way to educate, and you could bring rapid prototyping into a classroom, and you could start to challenge the conventions of exactly what you were talking about. And a lot of it is actually, I think, at a point where that's kind of snuffed out of a child. You know, they have it intuitively, it's there, and then the system kind of beats it out of them over time. And there's a lot of people that are trying to work to change that. There's a really great school called Alt School, which is in the Bay Area. By one of the founders, I guess he was an early employee at Google or Facebook, I can't remember which one, but he started the school. It uses all rapid prototyping. They do project-based learning, and they come together. There's another school that just started in Paris. It's really interesting. It's called 42 School. No teachers, no books, no tests, no tuition. And they had 40,000 applicants. They whittled it down to 250. And it's just mentorship. So the mentors come in, it kind of works in some ways like an accelerator. So there's different things that you can find from different industries, which relates to that idea of being able to pivot, being able to free yourself, give yourself the permission to do so, and not be so wounded when something doesn't work out, not being so defeated when something works out. Because, you know, I don't think life is only going to deal you more and more things that don't work out. So the sooner that you can take something and spin it, pivot, whatever, the better, I think. So I think hopefully if that stuff can work its way in earlier in education and be there, hopefully we can help.
And if I could just offer one more perspective on it. So I spent 12 years as publisher of IndieWire, and we covered the independent film space. And as a news outlet, we were very conscious in our newsroom that couldn't just reinforce the Cinderella story. Because the easy story to tell was, little filmmaker goes to Sundance, film gets bought for $1 million, and that guy's name was Darren Aronofsky. And like, but that creates this impression among filmmakers, among the other 320 filmmakers who went to Sundance that year, that if they didn't sell their film for $1 million, they were a failure. When in reality, they were a success for like making out of the pile 10,000 films that were submitted to Sundance. And so we knew as an editorial outlet that we had to balance the kinds of stories we told, the kind of role models that we gave filmmakers, so that we weren't just encouraging the selling out, as you were saying. So I think that that's something that maybe we as a culture have gotten really bad at. We love awards, we love the Oscars, we love, well, we don't want the Grammys, who cares about the Grammys, right? But these kinds of awards, I think, are where people tend to focus a lot of their energy, and then not winning that, not winning the Oscar feels like a defeat, even though only 5 films made it to the nomination, and only 400 films got released. And so when you look at the chain of success, I think figuring out where the bar is of success that you won, rather than just being the top, is something that a culture we need to be thinking more about.
Do we have time for like 1 more, 2 more?
I'm curious for you guys to kind of continue on where you're going. It's kind of starting at the beginning. I think you've done an excellent job of articulating failures that occur when you already have a job, but I'd like to know.
You have jobs? Do we have jobs?
I don't have a job. What are you talking about?
Or you've had jobs, you're successful people, otherwise.
I do work. I do a lot of work that nobody pays me for, but I don't have a job.
But you're talking about like when you're starting out?
Yeah, because as a recent graduate, it's really hard to get the work to put yourself in a place where you can fail. So you're failing before you even have the opportunity to fail. And so and I think that's kind of what Lance was discussing, what you were just discussing as well, about kind of changing our perspective on being thankful that we were even nominated or something like that. So
so once upon a time, I was fired from my dream job, basically. I was very lucky. A bunch of my friends made a company. They hired me, we made a beautiful game, and then one day all of us were fired and out of work, and it was really terrible. I cried and cried, and then I didn't find a job. I searched for a job. I went on interviews to places like MTV, where I said, I do immersive, interactive, digital, and they said, digital? Oh, that's banner ads and SEO. And that was not what I did. And so long story short, nobody was willing to hire me. And this was really horrible because we still had a mortgage to pay and on and on. And so what I did was I started making stuff, and I really, really dumb, tiny stuff. I wrote a short story in a Google Calendar to see if I could. And I started a Twitter account to tell horoscopes because it seemed like it might be a fun thing. And I did a project called My Super First Day, where I made a website where people sent in their origin story as a superhero. None of these things made a cent of money. Most of them were really terribly thought through, and they are by no means my finest work. But the point is, I was making stuff, and I was getting my name into the community. Like, when you keep trying and trying and trying, even if you fail and fail, eventually someone's going to see you trying, and you're going to connect with other people who are also trying to do other things. So as I continued these efforts of making things, I was building out kind of a portfolio, and eventually people did in fact start hiring me for real money that I could pay my mortgage with. So the moral of the story, as far as I'm concerned, is even if nobody is paying you, if you want to make stuff, make the kind of stuff that you want to make. If you don't have a film crew, film it on your phone. If you don't have a web developer, then, you know, make it on, is it Wix, I think, is the new GeoCities. to do whatever it is that you want to do with the materials that you can actually have access to. Scale down if you have to, but don't wait, don't ask for permission, just do the thing, because that's the only way the thing will ever get done.
And I think maybe that, I want to pick up, I totally agree, that I think another problem that people, like, in the beginnings of their career have is they want to make the great work. They want to make the $100 million film. They want to write the great American novel. And I always say, like, save that for your 30s or 40s. like that make flawed stuff. Like even the people I know who were successful before the 30s and 40s, it was accidental. Like Mike and Greg and Ed with Blair Witch Project. They were making something that they could make with their hands and the no budget. They bought a camcorder from Best Buy and filmed a film and then returned it because there was a 30-day no questions asked return policy. So like this ability to, was that the big movie that they all wanted to make? No, this was something that was within their capabilities and within their budget. And sometimes lightning will strike, but at other times it at least provides a stepping stone that gets you to the next thing. And I'm gonna do a call out to a guy named Zach Goldberg, who I think is a great example. This young guy was applying for a job with Criterion. How many of you guys know the Criterion film collections? So he decided he was going to make animated versions of five of the Criterion collection covers, his vines. They are so cool. As part of his job resume submission to Criterion, I'm like, I've never had anyone, like, I've seen a lot of resumes, I've hired a lot of people, but they've all been the same. And the idea that if someone had done that, like literally made little pieces of work that were specific to here's how passionate I am about why I want this job, I think that that's another good direction, is this idea of making something that's very explicitly what first work is, which is a calling card to get you work. So that you're not just looking at a resume with a set of skills, but actually seeing it put into practice even if it's small. Your time for one more?
Yeah, I got a question. I sit in a lot of meetings, I do a lot of pitches with groups and try to get people convinced about, you know, exploring territories or areas that are a little, you know, foreign to them. And there's always this like this feeling in the room that nobody wants to talk about the possibility of failure. And I usually bring it up, like, and if we fail, this is what we do next. And everyone looks at me like, why are you saying that? And, you know, I wonder as like leaders and as like people, you know, I know Lance's work, you know, it's kind of groundbreaking. I mean, how much does the conversation where you're thinking of failure as an advantage, but before you encounter success or failure down the road, but think of it as like, okay, you guys are working on success, you guys are working on failure. Is there like a progress? You know what I mean? Where you're, the story continues, but you start preparing for the animal, you just jump right into phase two as soon as you encounter that. Do you have any stories or any best practices of how you start the ball rolling with the team where you're encountering or you're going to go up against something that you just are not going
to? I used to do what you did. My version of it that would make everyone look at me in horror was everything I've ever done was a failure when I launched it, but every day I had a 1% improvement on its outcome. So if you give me 100 days, I can guarantee you success. And like people are like kicking me under the table, like Clark, can't say that it's always a fit. But it's like, you know, you have this idea in your head. You don't really know until you get it out in the world and see how people respond to it. And then you can build success from that. So I don't think failure is something that's unrecoverable. Like it's about how do you make survivable mistakes instead of fatal ones. Right, and you not win the Darwin Award, right? And that's the only set of failure that I think you have to be afraid of, is a really cataclysmic part.
I'd like to say that when I launch everything, I've never had a launch go smoothly. I have super anxiety the week before that project will suck, everybody will hate it, everybody will hate me personally as a side effect, and I will never work again. Every single project. But what I found is that even in the case that you make a really crappy project that only 10 people notice and they don't even like it, the thing is nobody remembers your failures. Everybody forgets. They just kind of flow under the river and they're never spoken of again because people only pay attention to the things that struck them in some way, that moved them. And if you didn't move them, except maybe to great hatred and death threats, then the failures just kind of disappear.
If I can give one more piece of advice too, I love people in pain. I love brands in pain, I love companies in pain, because they basically can't keep doing what they're doing. What they're doing has gotten them to exactly where they are right now. And so only brands in pain innovate. All innovation comes from pain. And so when I see bad news in the headlines, I start figuring out how I can email them. Because I'm like, no, like seriously, because like, here's an opportunity. Here's a situation where the universe has forced you to not be able to do the status quo. Or if you are, then you're dead. You're dead at all. If you can only keep doing what got you into the trouble that you're in, then you're dead. So I think looking for the right people who are willing to take risks is often the same thing as looking for brands in second place. Like, no one should want to work for Red Bull or Apple. They should want to work for the second or third competitor to that who has to figure out how to upset that existing balance. So if you do that, I think you might get slightly different reactions to the idea of risk and failure because they're already failing. So therefore, you can't mess it up. The cover of their book has been pre-defaced for you.
But if I could, I love this quote by Buckminster Fuller. If you guys don't know who Buckminster Fuller is, architect, visionary. Don't waste time fighting systems that exist. Build new systems that make those systems obsolete. You know, so a lot of times, if you're kind of going and you're kind of hitting your head against the wall with something, you know, just figure out how you can actually kind of create it. And you can make it, as we were saying, because it becomes part of that story. It becomes part of a greater story. And then eventually new opportunities will open up. But sometimes the risk aversion, there's a whole bunch of different reasons why it exists. But I think if you can find a way to even make that work in a small way, to be able to demonstrate it, you can do so much more with it. And I think it's really funny because right now we're sitting at this time that's unprecedented. Talk about the democratization of the tools, but there's like direct connection to audience in ways that have never happened before, where you don't have to. So now you're encountering a lot of times where what used to be a development culture in certain aspects of the industry has now become a thing where the more you prototype, the more you can actually show something, the better it is if you're going to sit in the rooms, if you can demonstrate some type of an audience in and around what the work is. But it's a chicken and an egg thing, right? You know, for when I was talking about VidCon, they kind of, when you look at some of the content, you're like, wow, I can't believe this resonates. One of the top people on YouTube is a woman that sits with her hands and opens kids' toys. She has like more views than Psy does. So she makes like over 7 figures a year. She literally sits there and talks about what she's opening. And it's like Christmas every day, you know, and toddlers go crazy for it. You know, she literally has like over more billions of views, you know. It's like, so then you look at it, you know, that's enough to kind of drive you insane. You know? Oh, okay, I need to just get my hand up there.
I'm trying too hard.
Yeah, exactly. So I think it's interesting, and I think in some cases just kind of look and see what else is going on too. But don't, you know, if it's not working in the rooms, just go and just do it. You know, find some small way that you can make it, some way that you can demonstrate it. And I know that we have to close the panel, but we'll right, I think. And I'll let you have the last word because you're the moderator. But I can totally talk to you about this.
Actually, our host gets the last word.
Apparently. Yeah. Well, I'd really like to thank our panel. If you could just join me there. Thank you all for coming out today. Thank you guys very much. You, Dredd, and Klaus for Genevieve, who helped us organize this evening. So thank you very much. Thank you all for coming to The Art of Failure. Thank you for talking to us a little bit about failure. And thank you for making tonight such a huge success. Oh, see what I did there? Please check out our website and all that stuff for more things like Convergence, The Art of Failure, more free programs, and of course, the New York Film Festival. It is coming. It is coming like the tide. Anyhow, thank you all very much. Have a good night. Thank you very much. That's it.